Welcome. In this video we discuss how we set up a gas phase combustion reaction using the simple chemistry approach in FDS 6.7.6. The focus will be on defining a gas mixture as combustible gas by using the lumped species concept. We will also look at different ways how one can provide a value for the heat of combustion. If you're interested in the complex stoichiometry, please click on the card in the corner for an introductory video. Alright, I said in an earlier video that the gas phase combustion reaction here is only a placeholder. Now we will adjust it in preparation of the upcoming inverse modeling process. As a general principle, FDS uses a surrogate fuel concept to model the gas phase combustion reactions. The reasons are primarily the computational cost that is associated with the mass transport of a species through the domain. Also, in reality, it is uncertain what contributes to a fire. For example, think about an apartment or warehouse where many different materials can be involved. In these cases, it's fundamentally unclear what specific gas components are released by the different materials and then are also taking part in the combustion. In our case here, one could argue that PMMA is well enough understood so that we know it mostly releases its monomer, the MMA, when it is heated up. I would suggest to have a look at this article here. In the beginning, the authors provide a nice overview over studies that are conducted on PMMA. However, I would like to use a more general approach here that could be used with more complex materials. So this work here could basically be understood as a proof of concept. Have a look into the video description. There should be a link to this article. Let's first have a look at how FDS deals with the heat of combustion parameter. For this, I have prepared these three FDS simulations. They contain the material and surface definitions that we have set up before in our pyrolysis model with the MCC data. You can click on the card in the corner to watch the respective video. There are some changes conducted to the surface definition. For instance, the parameters related to the TGA analysis have been removed. Instead, the external flux parameter was added. This will imprint the radiative heat flux to the sample surface, in this case 65 kW per square meter. The energy introduced by this will then drive our pyrolysis process. Furthermore, I would like to highlight that we are now considering a gas phase combustion reaction, so that means we will have a flame in the simulation. You see that the mesh resolution here is relatively coarse. However, that does not matter too much here, we just want to have something to assess mass loss rates and energy release. We will discuss this general setup in a different video in more detail. This will be related to when we set up the inverse modeling process with the simplified cone calorimeter. Again, look for the card in the corner to get the link to said video. Anyway, apart from the adjustments to the sample surface, this is basically the same file as we set up for the MCC simulation. Just the heat of combustion was changed to 25 megajoules per kilogram. A few devices have been added as well to keep track of different mass fluxes. In the setup for the second simulation, the heat of combustion parameter has been removed from the material definitions. Let's have a look at these two simulations first. The results of these examples are provided at the end of the assess pyrolysis gas notebook. This first cell computes the theoretical sample mass that can be released as gaseous species. The individual parameters here are just taken from the FDS input file. The sample volume is computed from the vent dimensions as well as the thickness parameter provided in the surface definition. The new spec parameter from the material definition then provides us with the amount of mass that is transformed into the species. This leaves us with a theoretical species mass of roughly 115 grams. Here in this next cell, the different device and heat release files are read in. This is then followed by a couple of plots. The cells to create these plots are all following the same scheme. The mass loss and energy release data from the simulations is plotted, and also integrals over the respective data series are computed. The first plot on the left-hand side shows the burning rates. These are the mass loss rates determined by the simulation in the solid phase. On the y-axis, we have plotted the mass loss rate, and on the x-axis, the time in seconds. The data series labels indicate two different heat of combustions, 25 and 50 megajoules per kilogram. Above the plot, the values from the integration are presented. With this, we see that, broadly speaking, the mass loss from the solid phase is roughly the same for both of them, and they are also close to the theoretical value. On the right-hand side, we see that the mass loss rates in the gas phase are different, specifically when looking at the total values from the integration. The species mass that is introduced into the fluid domain for the 25 megajoule case is half of that of the 50 megajoule case. So that raises a question, why is that? As was alluded to earlier, in FDS, the combustion is controlled by some overarching gas phase reaction definition. Typically, a single reaction is defined in the react line, but one could also provide multiple. Different materials that are set up in the input file could then burn differently based on different average heat of combustion. For this, the individual heat of combustion values can then be prescribed in the material definition. So these can be, and likely are, as is highlighted here, different from the heat of combustion that is defined in the react line. Based on these values, FDS then scales the amount of gas that is introduced into the fluid domain. This concept is referred to as a surrogate fuel. With this, the simulation can maintain the energy release even so only a single gas phase combustion reaction was defined. So in our case, methane is a surrogate fuel. It is predefined with about 50 megajoules per kilogram. We can check that if we go into the .out file of the simulation. When we scroll down, we see that at some point there is information provided about the gas phase reaction. Here, the surrogate fuel is methane. Its heat of combustion is 50 megajoules per kilogram. This is true for both simulations. We are in the out file of the first simulation, we go into the out file of the second simulation, and also methane and 50 megajoules. The difference is in the definition in the input. So we look into the input file of the first simulation. There we had set up a heat of combustion of 25 megajoules per kilogram. Since in the second simulation this parameter was removed, the combustion is computed with the original predefined heat of combustion of methane. Since we did set the heat of combustion value in the material to 25 megajoules per kilogram, the amount of methane introduced into the fluid domain is cut in half to match the requested energy release. This also indicates another thing. The solid and the gas phase are different simulations. They are connected but not directly, at least not in the 1D heat transfer case. So in my head I visualize this as both simulations, the fluid and the solid simulation, are living in different parallel universes. They are connected through some Stargate type portal. However, that image is not quite right because in the movie they still end up in our universe, it's just another planet. But with FDS, the end of the portal is in a different universe. This issue is also visible with the restrictions when setting up the heat transfer through walls in the 1D case. Anyway, we can also adjust the heat of combustion in the reaction definition directly. This is, for instance, when we want to define a new species that is unknown to FDS. However, it seems that there are some limits. For instance, I couldn't set the heat of combustion in the react line to 25 megajoules while using methane. In that case, I just wouldn't see combustion happening in smoke view. However, right now I'm not interested in setting up a new combustible gas species, so therefore we skip that here. After we used individual gas species before, we are now looking into gas mixtures. These mixtures can also be used to define a surrogate fuel. Thinking a bit about the heat of combustion. This is the energy release from a given amount of mass during a combustion reaction. So we could create a gas mixture that has some combustible component and also a fraction of non-combustible gas mixed in. With that, we can influence the average heat of combustion of this total mixture. Here in example 3 I have set up such a gas mixture. It consists of two components, methane and carbon dioxide. Both are initialized here as lumped components only. Since both of them exist only as part of the mixture in the simulation, FDS does not need to track them individually. I've adjusted both of these fractions manually to get in the ballpark of a heat of combustion of 25 megajoules per kilogram. This fuel mixture is then used as surrogate fuel in the reaction. Also, there is no heat of combustion defined in the materials. Just the species ID was adjusted to the mixture. If we then look in the out file of simulation 3, under the gas phase reaction information we find that our fuel is now the fuel mixture and its heat of combustion is roughly 25 megajoules per kilogram. This value emerges from the mixture of these two components. Since there is no heat of combustion defined in the material, the mass of the surrogate fuel produced in the solid is moved right through into the fluid domain. So now we add these results to the plot. On the left hand side we still see that in the solid phase all of the mass loss rates fit together and the total masses released of all cases are very close together. We also see now that the mass release of simulation 3 is now roughly double what we had for the 25 megajoule case. With that then, we can get the mass loss in the solid, the amount of mass of the surrogate fuel introduced into the fluid domain, and also the energy release on the fluid side to all fit together. Just keep in mind that FDS uses the radiative fraction parameter to determine how much of the energy released in the reaction zone is radiated away. In the FDS user guide of version 6.7.6, table 16.1 gives us the default radiative fractions for the predefined fuels. So we see here methane is predefined with a radiative fraction of 0.20. All species that are not listed above are initialized with a default value of 0.35. Our gas mixture is such a case where the radiative fraction is set to 0.35. Therefore, in this simulation I added a radiative fraction of 0.2 to the combustion reaction. This allows us to better compare the results of this simulation to the one that is only running with methane. Otherwise, the flame would introduce more energy into the sample. That would lead to a faster reaction. Now the plot on the left hand side shows us the energy release. We see here that the energy release from simulations 1 and 3 fit together, and on the right hand side we see that the mass loss rates of simulation 2 and 3 fit together. Again, adding the carbon dioxide to the gas mixture allows us to have the energy release correct as well as the mass loss. This is also nicely visible from the integrated values. The energy release of simulation 3 is close to our theoretical value, so is the mass loss. Okay, going forward I'll be using a gas mixture as surrogate fuel. During the IMP the concentrations are then fine-tuned. For the individual components of the gas mixture I will be using predefined gas species. With this, FDS can still employ the simple chemistry and compute the stoichiometry. It does not need to be provided by the user. This also incorporates the soot yield parameter. So in the next video we will set up the inverse modeling process that all the parameters that we have discussed before can be fine-tuned. If you found this video helpful, please leave a like. Otherwise, see you in the next video. Bye!